received the US dollar, that are legitimate instead of, you know, obviously didn't compete with the US dollar.
But you know, you raise a very good question. I'm not aware of any statute, federal or state, that says there's an absolute monopoly on forms of currency, as there is in other things. Like, you know, that slot in the door that's called the where you can put a letter through the door or a mailbox. There's actually a law that says that the U.S. Postal Service has a monopoly, and that's why UPS is not allowed to put their boxes or anything in there. There is a government fiat monopoly. But you raise a very good question. What we've found in the last 10 years with Bitcoin, with really oversimplifying, is that it is legal to create your own form of money, as Bitcoin is possibly this money. But you have to comply with all the other laws. And all those other laws that we'll talk about in other lectures, in essence, fall into buckets of guarding against illicit activity. So the Bank Secrecy Act and all the laws related to anti-money laundering and terrorism finance and so forth, that one still has to pay your taxes if you're gaining or losing on this investment. The Federal Reserve and other authorities around the globe still want to ensure for financial stability.
Gary Gensler, professor at MIT, 2018, before becoming SEC chair. He was talking about blockchain and Bitcoin, you know, very positively quite some time ago.
What is a ledger?
What is a ledger? Very good question. I'm going to be chatting about that in a minute, but does anybody want to hit that?
Does anybody want to hit that?
No, we're over here.
I was going to say, it's just a numerical record of everything recorded in a fashion.
A numerical record. I think that's a good thing. A ledger is basically a way to record economic activity or social relationships or financial relationships. I would say it's both a way to record economic activity, and it's a system of recording financial relationships. And while I didn't assign these readings, very good academic research suggests that the first methods of writing and symbols of writing had to do with numbers and had to do with ledgers rather than words and communication. Because it's so fundamental to society to record various economic transactions or to record the financial relationships amongst and between members of a community, whether it was a small village or when society burst out of villages thousands of years ago.
Welcome back to another Soul Days. Crazy week, but let's get it started. If you're new to the show, please like and subscribe. I promise, not a pro government guy. Where I'm not anti-government or con-government or whatever you want to say either. But I am pro-crypto. And I'm pro-price and portfolio pump. So let's look at the charts. Looking at Bitcoin. Wow. Closing out around 19,500. If we can get back up on that mark, wrote out this line here on our 8-day schedule, mapped out there using solid angles. No trend lines. We don't work on opinion here. But I'm just kidding. But yeah, using our RSI, these times RSI stochastic deviations come in really handy. You're gonna need some indicators, but you don't want to use these as laggers. You want to figure out how you can use these as lead indicators. See here, I go off head and shoulder. I look for bullish divergence patterns, not just bullish bearish divergence patterns. Period. See, so we're starting to average out here earlier, right in the middle of our price range on the RSI. So I put down another RSI here for an inverse readout. I'm looking for crevices to give me bearish indicating leads on a three-point schedule here, on a three-point head and shoulder plan. Diagonals, looking for a history. Show this if this is working here. Let's see, one, two, three. It's being the head. becoming bearish, depending on where we're ending up. Peak to peak means bearish. And on a crevice or a valley, it's bullish. Right? So we're averaging out. Our deviations are weighing heavier on the overbought side. We know something's coming, right? So we have what we call the downtrend here. One, two, three, shoulder, head, shoulder, coming down, right, ending at the peak of my bottom stochastic. Overbought, we know we've been trending. Deviation's been pretty standard here, right? Not too much, cross peak to peak. Just a little bit here, a little bit here. More or less, averaging out on the overbought side. Peaked out here, went down, got bearish. So once I had my head formed and my shoulder came lower than the head, even though we had a rising bottom here, we're averaging out towards the middle. So definitely weighing heavy on the top side. We know we're gonna pour out, and we did. We spilt down, here we go. CPI. So we hit, I hit a head here right on a lonely mountain on my Bollinger Band. My bottom limit was staying tight on the 20, really high on the upside. So we hadn't trended yet on the overbought as much, on the deviation rather, on the oversold side. So we came out of this looking really bullish on the upside, right? For a decent amount of time here. We had really defined head and shoulders periods, right? So when we travel in these valleys, when we live in these valleys for a little bit, right, and power isn't being swayed, we know it's getting bullish, right? Pressure is building. And so I'm watching for how I set mine up is I have my fasts on the blue crosses, and I like to see a steady rhythm on dance. And I know that we're getting solid flow on the volume because our shoulders are getting, our peaks are getting defined here. And I have clear head and shoulders. So you hear one, two, three, ended on a head on the crevice, huge move up. So when I seen that I had a shoulder formed here and a head here and another shoulder forming out into another head, things got interesting, right? Because I ended on a peak here. So I know if I'm not already out, we're going lower. And we did, we got really oversold here. Not enough to tell me for a little bit on my deviation standard. And I mentioned it on Twitter too, that the deviation standards aren't giving me a high probability for more downside, right? And boom, we moved up. Same thing down. You can see a lot of instances I circled them off, but you usually get end of peaks, end of three head and shoulder peaks. What I like to call a Batman here is really bullish. I get mutant shoulders every once in a while, but you start to get really well-defined head and shoulders areas, and you start to get mutations of these on high volume areas. At least you can figure out how to decipher your own patterns. But here, massive crevice, moving in, more bear, more downside. However, I knew here we were setting up for a reversal or a different trend here on our bull. So I set up a bull here and our path got set. We started to standardize up there. This one was interesting because our deviations were weighing out equally on both sides. However, frequency was a lot less. So the Bollinger Band became a little bit more ambiguous because I had a lot of gas. What I refer to as this purple space here from the upper and lower limits. But you can see our time frame reference, and this is the same lines that we've been drawing out here for some time. And so what I did was just spread these out based on the same time frame that I've been using, which is 8 days. And the stochastic RSI, really interesting and important to note too, is that works on a 14-day typically, depending on how you want to read it or whatever. But so does block schedules on Bitcoin. 2 weeks. All right. And so when I map out anyway, my time frame. I use fixed angles. I don't like to use trend lines too often unless it's straight lines, or unless I'm doing it for a particular reason to provide a stronger opinion for me to follow. But the reason why I use hard angles is just that I don't want to use opinion too much when I'm using my chart area. I use the indicators to give me opinions or base my opinions on. And then, so here I did 8 days, right? 8 days spread. So same, this is the same chart. I've been talking about how I divide them into threes and then usually build it off of speed fans to project outwards fans to give myself some kind of forecast. But we've been trending on this channel here, and you can start to see if you use market psychology or Elliott predominantly, you can start to see patterns, right, where greens occur and reds occur across these channels, and you can use these days to decipher quite possibly, or just continue to map it out how they're gonna work. And so we knew that we went 1 2 3 1 2 3, so we had a triple 3 1 2 3 1 1 2 3 2 1 2 3 3, and this is a one right here, so ending on a one, starting on a one here. That was a triple 3. So normally what we're looking for is another triple 3, and that will give us three triple threes. Or if we have a triple 3 and we go into a double 3, that we know that that trend area has ended on a double 3. Triple 3s can precede, can follow two triple 3s. And if it does, it usually ends up with a 1 on the bottom, and that would indicate a bullish move. And we have one here. And we ended up having that move right on this 8-point line, 8-day line, which is actually becoming 16, right? So this is 4 days here, treading across this channel, everything divided up. And so I move this angle down. If I move this angle down, it looks further separated because these are 8 days and this is 16 and 16. So I move that one based on this trend here, prolonging. So we had an extended, what you might call, or what you would refer to as an extended period. So with Bitcoin, if we're looking for a new move, right, go ahead and mark an 8-day period here, and our probability is giving us more oversold than overbought right now. We're going to start to weigh heavier on the oversold quite possibly, but we have a rising bottom. So I have a three head and shoulders here, averaging out, really mutant head here. Our deviations are looking a little bit more wide because oversold side is weighing a little bit heavier, even though it's happening less frequently. Although these peaks have ran pretty high, the duration is shorter somewhat than these. And I'm also seeing a lot of valleys here, some deep, long valleys here. So, and really when we see crevices, valleys here, we get bullish moves, right? When we end up on a valley here, we get a green up, right? When we end up on a valley here, we get a green up, valley, green up. And we're getting some good lead indicators based on our three well-defined points here. 1, 2, 3. It could be possible that we're entering a stretch here of unlikelihood, which is more flat and more downside, or you're getting ready and waiting because we have a shoulder forming out here. Is it gonna come down more and invalidate? So then we wanna start looking at the probability, looking at possibly 16.9, which will take us further deeper into wave one on the long term Elliott side, which would be really interesting because now we're really, really starting to confirm the long term trend, which is eating into wave one, and really, really waiting out this either C or wave 5B, either one. But we're looking for these to conclude and finish off a really, really strong bearish pattern here overall on the Elliott corrective side. And you see long-term, looking at the 1 month, our candle's still red, right? So even though we had instances of green and strong moves up overall, it's been red. And if this candle is really trying to stretch out to this bottom resistance here at 17.5 and it goes any lower, you know, we had one marked here at 12,600. So coming down to 14, or as we said, 16.5 in the short term is possible within the next six to eight days on the low caps. So you see averages here on this DMI. I'm using directional movement index. And I like to pair that sometimes too with the Bollinger Band. So if what I call smoke here, getting a lot of smoke. I pointed out these schedules here, threes. Again, market psychology typically works out in threes. So I often look for those just as points of reference. But you can even say that this is starting here, right? One, two, three, and then we come down. The initial first down is usually the lowest point and never goes lower than that. And if our second wave is lower than 50 or more than 50% retracement, then it invalidates the first one, so you gotta start over. Arguably, this is the one, the lowest point on the 20, on a our resistance, hit it right on the mark, 23.9. What was previously really strong resistance at 27, provided some really soft support. We hit it once, and that was enough to break through again. So now we're channeling here. As we mentioned several shows ago, we'd likely channel back in here. And that was actually a good thing because we get into our lower third fan on the speed resistance. And usually when that happens, we see it here. We make these huge moves up. So we already have three moves here. Arguably, maybe it happened here once already. So maybe we could be on the first move of a larger scale move. So one, two, three. And maybe this is one here. One, two, three. Move down. One, two, three. So this could be actually the second wave here, and we're looking for our third final big wave here on the classic, and then maybe go into another three. So triple threes usually. So two triple threes in a row will usually define out another triple three move to finish it off. And then where we go from there, we got to reset. But maybe you can make the argument here that the trend started here at the lowest point, and we had a three move up here already. So one, two, three, reset, one, two, three, reset. One, two, three, reset. One, two, three. Or one, two, three. Yeah, one, two, three, reset. One, two, three, three. And here we go. So we're looking for another move up here on this into the heavens. I like to use the Ichimoku cloud sometimes too. Been experimenting with it. One of my new favorite indicators. Here we have pressure, huge pressure building actually. And so less standardization now and more deviation. Gonna probably result in some wild swings. So you're gonna see some zigzagging, right? And we're gonna start to look for three moves here. So likely we have a bit of training to do because we hit our lowest point if this is. If we're going to go lower, then we have to break this up into a more massive, into a more cohesive, understandable movement. So you could say this is the one, two, three, four, five on the Elliott, and then we're on the corrective side. So once we start eating into wave one, like we are now, we want to look for percentages on ratios. We're already eating pretty heavy into this. This looks way more than 10% on this retracement here. We don't really need 90s on Elliott's. So I say this is more than enough to confirm here, but if we need to go down, you know, that's fine because we're already eating into wave one. So you're waiting, you're anticipating on a move. And in that case, we just broke through this 27 already. So our next resistance, soft resistance, could be a 29. So I believe that we're gonna start to look for, let's look out for three on the classic. It looks like it already actually touched, it wicked up there, right? Breaking three, we'd likely hit 34 and possibly looking for 35, taking us up into the bottom of the upper third. Once we hit the upper third, then we're starting to look for moves. However, I do think we're gonna zigzag it for a little bit based on history here. Solana, we said that we'd be closer to the mid-20s at the end of the start of the 2 weeks in September, but we're in the middle. I even asked for her. We even called for 49 on my Twitter, but didn't get really close at all. We had the CPI report come and just turn things around too. So, however, we're still channeling right in here. Fell right into our middle fan, pulling off of this corrective side on the downtrend totally. And I like to start my trends from the start of the trend, which is here. However, I do think that this should be incorporated here because based on the time schedule and the way the volumes are working out, I'd rather incorporate this downtrend because I'm seeing some strong bullishness here and nothing got exhausted overall as we see a lead diagonal forming here. But I want to use this, like I said, because seeing all this, the sea of red here, I think the trend is actually still building from this. Bulls love to see red and they get crazy. This market is really, really getting really juicy. If we go any lower, you know, people won't be able to contain themselves. The world and the market economy is looking for somewhere to put their money right now, looking for something to make money on. Another look at Solana on the 1 day, hit right up on this ramp and then we fell over it right into our mid fan. So now we're in speed resistance mode. Like we said, we were looking for a double three here, 32 days. If you want to break that down into thirds, yeah, maybe you could even go 11 if you wanted to, or 10. 10 might be better, you know, giving us about a 33% likelihood of fanning out here, right into here on a double three, going to shoot up here if we go lower. However, we're going to double three right in this middle fan. SHIB, got my Ichimoku on here with my DMI, directional moving index. Want to look at the time frames of those. SHIB staying right along with the market psychology. We usually get 3 moments. We're going to get a crossover on price. Then we're going to start to look for resistance again. This is just waiting to go. On our daily average, if we're hitting 12 being our high, this being the lower speed fan, we're going to follow this down until we hit 10, likely. Based on the daily average, we're looking at a few days of potential move down. We're getting some bearish moves with the bottom falling out here. If we continue to be bearish like this, we could get some bullish divergence unless we get the unlikelihood, right, of a pattern here where it just stretches out and we get extended flats. All right, Solana Beach Validator on this show. We counted it. The continued improvement of blockchain, Solana being one of them. We saw the validator account on Solana jump within just 2 weeks, within 3 weeks, since I mentioned it on the show after the clockwork and the improvements on the blockchain, Solana blockchain, and connectivity, providing more opportunities for dApps. The snapshot at the time, I believe, was 1913 validator count, 1913. Although I only took a screenshot of a 1,927, I posted it on Twitter, but still up to this point, that's almost 1,000 validator increase within 3 weeks on Solana. That is excellent. Excellent. Super excited for Solana and crypto overall. And that just goes to show you how fast this space is growing. All right. SHIB. Even though we fell down right out of this diagonal, which was kind of bearish anyway, but we're looking for some upside based on the market sentiment and psychology. Thinking that we're going to have a reversal, but CPI pulled us back pretty hard. However, SHIB, burn supply, we've been decreasing. So transactions been going down, activity has been going down. However, we hit a turning point possibly here, right? And now we're seeing activity peak up and burning tick up again, right? However, price has been actually kind of decreasing, right? Price has been slowly declining, but the burn rate is increasing. Activity is still there. We're seeing some market confidence enter again. We're looking at the SHIB news. Had some wag the dog type news about SHIB whale selling right before the SHIBaverse and other pretty exciting marketing news coming from SHIB. And then they bought more than they sold back. Seeing SHIB take on new users. SHIB is the longest held crypto, even more longer than Bitcoin. That's crazy. You know, on my Twitter early last year, I said that SHIB was the new Bitcoin. Of course, got scoffed and laughed at. Not taken seriously at all, but it was because of those metrics, right? And here we're starting to see actual news sort of headline more frequently on SHIB now. And this has really actually been, if you've been following SHIB and you've been in SHIB, this is things that you've already been familiar with, right? SHIB continues to set new precedents with the continued frequencies just soaking up intellectual property Bitcoin and crypto is. Just the blockchain is just a freight train, just continuing to smash the Bitcoin blocking discovery rates. And so blocks are just getting discovered way faster. Block times are getting sharper. Hash rates are just continuing to skyrocket. We'll look at what happens when hash rate crosses price. However, here we go. You know, block times were once, you know, aimed at 10 minutes, or always were, but that what does that mean? You know, people are going to shoot for faster. Now it's averaging 8.5 minutes. So what was estimated to be April 2024 for that next halving, Bitcoin halving, this article is saying it could be as soon as March now. I think it's going to get pushed even closer to 2023. And when that starts to really hit more eyes, more ears, that news, it's going to really cause some massive FOMO. It's going to be a mad rush for Bitcoin and crypto. And with Ethereum's merge being the onset of Ethereum's merge being successful, you know, some people are saying the merge is complete. This is just the start of it. This is a long road ahead for Ethereum to be completely POS, proof of stake, and to, you know, to transfer a lot of the abilities of the blockchain. But overall, yes, merge is continuing to be successful. It has been, the initiation of it is, it has been surprisingly super successful. And that's extremely, extremely good for crypto. You know, it provides a clearer look at the scalability and the serviceability and also the safeness, the security of this blockchain. And that's exactly what financial markets need to see and hear from this growing industry, right? And especially when we have, you know, regulation necessarily waiting at our door for us. And if we really want these extreme price pivots and we want major money to get in and we want mass adoption to get, you know, to get really pumping again, we're going to need that, right? And we need to make this space ready for it. And this is building that infrastructure. And Vitalik is doing that, right? He's basing out this infrastructure like crazy. That's super good news. And awesome for Ethereum and everybody in crypto right now. And this move up already being calculated as soon as March 2024 from April, it's likely going to be sooner than that now. It's just going to create a mad rush. And this bottom, this supposed bear, you know, is really, really not looking very bearish for 2023. Looking at the 1 month here, and on the Elliott side, we've ate into the one wave. If we're this red candle here, this last red candle we're on right now is still red. So if we're chasing this one, we already said that we could go as low as 15,000. If we satisfy that 15,000 mark, if these prices continue, they get closer to that mark, or they get even more juicy, people are not going to be able to wait. It's just gonna, you know, like I said, institutions, individuals, mom and pops, everybody's looking for somewhere to put their money. Everybody's wanting to make money. So we see here, when the hash rate begins to chase away from price, right? And you have a downturn in price, that usually results in a reversal. And it doesn't happen, doesn't last very long. On the profitability, you see the same thing. So this hash rate chases away and it just continues to skyrocket here. You have a reversal in price, in trend. So COVID, halvings have an effect where people pull off, you have a lot of sell-off. Profitability here continuing to go down, price going down, yet hash rate just continues to skyrocket. This is a super competitive, highly desirable industry. A lot of demand. So block sizes, transaction fees are still down. Profitability is going down. Difficulty is still increasing. So there are more guesses, more hash rate, more energy being put into Bitcoin. Some point, this price is just begging to reverse, right? You see it here. Yeah. Just an increase in difficulty, increase in price. And then they're correlated here. But we have a pull away. Can't really pull away for that long. At some point, especially with the Bitcoin halving moving up, see here, difficulty just continuing to increase, but the price going down. Mining profitability going down, it really can't pull away for too long. This is just a highly competitive market. Just people just wanting to get in no matter what. The profitability is going down with competition. it can't continue to pull away. The price cannot continue to stay down for this long. At some point, you're going to have a reversal. And you see here on the downtrend, difficulty rising, and then continues to go up, but price does too. Then you have a reverse and a reset, and here we are again. So whenever these prices cross, price cross, we're going to have a price cross again, quite possibly. Ultrasound that money. So we're looking at ETH officially. Whoa, this is way down, but we were at 70, negative 70 ETH earlier. But officially, according to this, still minuscule, but officially Ethereum is deflationary. So 6% created on the year, but we have 6% being burned now on the average. We just started. So with Ethereum, gonna continue, you know, arguably, supposedly, mining profitability going down on Ethereum, but that's just because this market is just getting highly, highly competitive and desirable. We have a lot of intellectual property flooding into this market. More regulation, more authorities looking at making this market very feasible. So, and the halving coming up, it's just going to put so much pressure on the price and supply of all crypto. News articles on being bullish on the Classic. Bank of America saw this lead up to the merge. There's a lot of talk from very unlikely sources like Bank of America. And we'll see how these traditional sectors integrate. If they're going to partner, they're going to use blockchain, if they're going to become blockchains. But it's all extremely, extremely exciting. And who knows what to expect, really. However, the market needs to continue to grow financially feasible, you know, in that it needs to be more secure and scalable. And Ethereum is proving that right now. Solana is proving that right now. I know with the, you know, the blackouts on Solana, but I mean, what do you expect? It's trying to get mass market ready. You're going to have growing pains. It's, to expect a baby to be born perfect is, you know, I don't know. But even Ethereum had to go through an upgrade. So very, very exciting, very, very good for crypto. And Binance too. We haven't really looked in detail at Binance, but Binance is just a juggernaut as well. Bank of America talking about adoption of Ethereum, either providing it to clients, using it as an investment. The success of the merge they talked about, and its functionality, it could really prove itself to the financial sectors, the traditional finance sectors, that this is actually a market that is going to be serviceable. And that's amazing, because we saw that Ethereum has become officially deflationary and that the ETH merge has been initiated successfully. So higher quality yield is just becoming more and more competitive. You know, insurance protocols, whether they remain extremely decentralized or become a little bit less decentralized, you know, the instruments and dApps that are going to be built on it are really what's most important. Those are going to be really important to become decentralized. And the growth of those and the applications that we can use on distributed ledger technology are going to be extremely important, because those will end up being forcibly what make the deeper blockchains like Ethereum will eventually become more decentralized, because you can use what was already created on these blockchains as, you know, autonomous ledgers, trustless protocols. You can use those as dApps. You can choose what you use, what's provided by for on the blockchain. If the dApps themselves become centralized, then you have a problem. NFTs have been trending towards all-time lows on transactions for NFTs. And once this activity starts to really pick up again, because it will, it's just going to be the growth rate of Ethereum and Solana and other major blockchains, Binance, it's just going to be phenomenal. you know. And so you start, we want to start to look for opportunities like Kronos and Phantom, Wax, Softflow, getting named as Meta's main adoption. You know, whether, you know, yeah, I'm not going to speak on whether or not you support Meta. I think that they need to be, to kind of get more into the integrated system with crypto. Other options out there, you know, Avalanche continues to grow, things like that. Kronos, the price on Kronos pushing close to sub 10 cents now. It's just, you know, this, these prices are getting crazy, right? I really don't know how long this market can hold off FOMO. And you have people like Jim Cramer saying that we're, you know, Jim Cramer saying we're in a bear now, you know, now we're going down, where it's going to dump. Yeah, Binance up on Bitcoin. And what does that tell you? That just tells you that Bitcoin, man, that's just super, super prime, super ripe prices right now. Super ripe situation for fees on Bitcoin, fees being that low. It's just a massive reversal ready, just brewing. And so you have other ones here, Phantom, Near jumping up above Phantom now, Cardano, just these are all just a continuous race to the top. Solana still coming in strong, even up on Polygon. Polygon's got a lot going for it right now, especially with NFL starting up. But overall, this crypto market has a lot of opportunity baking in right now. And potential growth for crypto and its infrastructure is exponentially showing itself. Sun Gods got derugged by a community member, pretty reputable one from the Carex team, or at least a community mod, quite possibly. So we saw a little bit of return on price. Otherworld pumped up to where it is about now, earlier this morning. Probably an announcement, but I haven't been in the Discord for a little bit. But excellent, good to see. Community still strong, hanging in there. Goblin Games, Blackjack coming, some other card games. What I'm really looking forward to is the security as a service tool. Saudi Monkeys continuing to be deflationary. Stack that oil. Let's check the SODED. Community staying strong, continuing their AMAs pretty often now, pretty frequent. The Twitter spaces, seeing more people listening in every time. This community continues to grow, continuing to roll out things. Excellent. Art just always getting better. So, really exciting. It's awesome. Bear Market Beaver really turned back lately. Is this calling for the end of the bear? Here, Beaver is coming out of their burrows, escaping. But yeah, came down as low as 0.39 earlier. So. Anyway, have fun, trade safe, and see you in the next one. Thank you.